Okay, thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me to give this talk. I have to say that not only we are very grateful to Huawei for its very big support to IHS, but it is also a great pleasure for us, and in particular for me, to exchange with people working to Huawei for Huawei. It is a great pleasure for me today to give this talk. I hope you already see my slides. The title of my talk is on the creative power of categories. My talk is not meant to be technical, of course, but maybe nevertheless it will be too technical for people who don't know what is a category. But even in that case, I hope that my talk will make you dream a little. So it is not at all intended as a technical talk. And the theme of categories is, you will understand, very natural, because categories were developed a lot at IHS, especially by the most famous IHS professor, Grothendieck. And categories, as I shall also explain, are of great interest to some mathematicians working for Huawei. And they were at the heart of all exchanges between Huawei mathematicians, myself, and other mathematicians linked to IHS I will talk about. Okay. Excuse me. First, I want to give some elements of history. Categories were invented during the Second World War by two mathematicians, Samuel Eilenberg, who had escaped from Poland, and Saunders MacLane, who was an American mathematician. So I don't want to, of course, to give a precise definition. I only want to say that category is some kind of combinatorial object which can be partly seen as a picture. I mean that this object consists firstly in some dots. So just imagine dots on the white page. And these dots are related by arrows. An arrow always goes from one dot to another dot. And it is also possible that these two dots are the same. So in that case, you have one arrow going from one dot to itself. And it has also to be mentioned that for any two dots, there can be many arrows from the first dot to the second dot, and the arrows, there can be also arrows in the two directions. You see the two first data are dots and arrows, and the third data, which defines the category, is a composition law for arrows. So when you have two arrows relating three dots, such that the target of the first arrow is the source of the second arrow, then you should be able to associate to them a composed arrow going from the first dot to the last dot. Okay. So this, of course, has to verify some rules which I don't make precise. The definition of a category is very simple. The next definition, which was introduced by Eilenberg and MacLane, is the definition of a functor. A functor is a way to go from a category to another category, transforming dots of the first category into dots of the second category, arrows of the first category into arrows of the second category, in a way which is compatible with sources, targets, and composition laws. And the last notion, which was introduced by them, was a notion of transformation from a functor to another functor. So here I don't explain at all what it is. I only say that these three notions, in fact, by mathematical standards, are very simple. Samuel Eilenberg used to say that the most important paper he wrote in his last time was a paper without theorem, without result, and without proof, just with simple definitions. At the same time, categories were introduced. Another very important notion for us was introduced completely independently by the French mathematician Jean Leray. This was also during the Second World War, and in fact he was a war prisoner in prisoners' camps in Austria. So Leray invented the notion of sheaf. So in fact, his definition was slightly modified later by Cartan, but essentially it was given by Leray. He also defined sheaf cohomology, and he already at that step, he introduced a highly non-trivial technique, which he called the technique of spectral sequences. So this is a computing technique. So you see that on the categorical side, what Eilenberg and MacLane did was very simple, was basic. What Leray did already at that step was partly simple and partly technical. And here it has to be mentioned that later, in fact, 15 years later, sheaf theory will become the most important part of category theory. This is why I mentioned these two subjects. The first thing which has to be said about categories is that in category theory, the most important things are the most simple things. So I only want to quote a few remarks which have become extremely important for category theory. First, there is a so-called Yoneda lemma, which was introduced 10 years after the invention of categories. So this is just a remark with a one-sentence proof by Japanese mathematician Yoneda. This remark was popularized by MacLane, who understood it was important, and later, it was transformed into a powerful tool by Grothendieck. So this remark is that in any category, when you consider a dot or object, as mathematicians say, you can associate to it the network, the full network of relations to this dot. So this means a full network of sets of arrows whose target is the considered dot. And the remark by Yoneda is that if you know the network of relations, then you know the object you are talking about. And once again, the proof of this fact only requires one sentence. It is extremely elementary, but it has proved the most important basic fact of category theory. The other notions I want to mention were introduced 15 years after the birth of category theory by the American mathematician Daniel Kahn, who I want to mention that is still alive, and you can even talk with him. And so Daniel Kahn introduced two extremely simple notions, which I shall not fine, but it would just need a few lines. So first, the notion of pairs of adjoint functors. So this is the definition of a relation between two functors going from one category to another category in the two opposite directions. And a basic fact of this definition is that if you know one of these functors, then the other one is uniquely determined. And here, it can happen, it is a basic general fact, that one of these functors is extremely easy to define, is trivial, and the other one is subtle. And so this, in fact, this notion of adjoint functors provides an extremely general device to define interesting functors in category theory and so in mathematics. And the particular case of that are the notions of limits, or sometimes people say projective limits, and the notion of colimits, people also say inductive limits, in category theory. So these notions were also introduced by Daniel Kahn. Okay, so at that point, I already told you that categories mainly consist of simple facts. And so this means there are reasons not to believe in categories. And in fact, in the first years or decades of category theory, many people expressed doubts about category theory. So first, the first feeling one may have is that the notion of category and the derived notions which are associated to the notion of category are too general. Secondly, you can have the feeling that categories are too big. In general, they are much bigger than all objects of study previously studied in mathematics. For instance, people were used to study groups, which means to study one group or another group, or possibly a morphism from one group to another group. But if you are working with categories, then you will consider, for instance, all groups at the same time and all morphisms between groups. So this is a category. So this means it is huge. It is much, much bigger than anything which was considered before in mathematics. And the last feeling you may have is that category theory is too simple. It is too easy. In particular, in category theory, usually there are no tricks. Okay, and then I have to talk about Grothendieck. So Grothendieck, the first and the most famous IHS professor. And I have to talk about him because he was a mathematician who illustrated that category theory is extremely powerful. In fact, not only it is powerful, but it has a creative power. So this means that category theory, as shown by Grothendieck, has the power to create new mathematics. So how did Grothendieck do that? And many mathematicians did also that following the example of Grothendieck. So using the language of categories, what Grothendieck did is to illustrate the depth and the power of simplicity. So I already said that category theory is simple, but in fact, Grothendieck showed that simplicity can be extremely deep and powerful. And it is a lesson not only for mathematics, but also, I think, for other sciences, and maybe also for life. So I said that Grothendieck turned categories into an instrument of discovery and creation of new mathematics, and he did that always in the same way. He tried to reformulate and to understand, in terms of categories, key classical theories or results. So, by now, in the next minutes, I want to illustrate that by giving an idea of what Grothendieck did. So, the first example I want to give is a categorical definition by Grothendieck of the notion of moduli space. A moduli space is a space which classifies some type of algebraic structures. some type of structures, not necessarily algebraic. So for instance, you may want to classify lines in the plane. And what you get is a so-called projective line. You can also want to classify more complex things, for instance, to classify algebraic curves. And moduli problems of classifications of mathematical objects of some types had been considered before in mathematics. In fact, they began to be considered in the 19th century, I think, with Riemann. But almost a century, there was no precise definition of the notion of moduli space. There was a loose definition. People more or less understood what the word meant, but there was no mathematical definition of this notion. A mathematical definition has to be precise. And so Grothendieck proposed the definition for the notion of moduli space. And what he did for that purpose is just to use the trivial remark of Yoneda. The trivial remark of Yoneda is that if you consider an arbitrary category, then it is embedded by considering the networks associated to the object, the network of relations associated to objects of this category. So this category is embedded into the category of networks on that category. And so the idea of Grothendieck is that any classification problem defines a network on an underlying category. And then the problem of the moduli problem is to check whether an object of this category of networks comes from the underlying category, which is embedded in it. Here you see, you should think of the network category C hat as some kind of completion of the category C. So what you do is to consider an object in the completion and to wonder whether it comes from the smaller, more meaningful object. So it is exactly as if you consider a real number and you wonder whether this real number is rational or not. Another example is a categorification of Galois theory by Grothendieck. So Galois theory was a theory in algebra, a theory about algebraic equations. But Grothendieck made it incredibly more general. For that purpose, he considered a category C and he defined on a general category a notion of topology. And then, so this means a notion of localization. And then, this allowed him to define the notion of cover. A cover is an euro in the category. So here I have written the euro X to S. And you will call that euro a cover if locally for the topology you consider, it is identical to the projection from a sum of copies of the base to the base itself, which means it is a cover if locally for the topology you consider it is trivial. And then Grothendieck proved under extremely general conditions that categories of covers are equivalent to categories of actions of some group. So when you have a group, you can consider sets endowed with an action of the group. And this defines a category. And so Grothendieck understood that categories of covers under extremely general conditions are equivalent to categories of this type. And in doing that, Grothendieck unified two very important, two most important theories of mathematics, which so far were not related. On the one hand, Galois theory, and on the other hand, the Poincaré theory of fundamental groups, So using this categorical language, Rothenberg proved that these two theories are only one. And of course, by doing that, he generalized incredibly the scope, he extended incredibly the scope of Galois' theory. The next thing I want to mention is the categorification of the Riemann-Rohr theorem. So this theorem was born in the 19th century, so first by Riemann, then Rohr, who was a student of Riemann. It was a theorem for vector bundles over a geometric object. So for Riemann and Rohr, it was a vector bundle over a curve, and it was extended to vector bundles over geometric objects of arbitrary dimension by Hirzebruch in the late 50s. So it was this was a formula for vector bundles over a geometric object. And just after this formula was established in general by Hirzebruch, Rothenberg decided to try to understand it. And for him, understanding meant to understanding in terms of category theory. And in fact, what he did was to transform this formula into a drawing. And here on the page, I have written this drawing. So you see it is a square. I don't want to explain the terms, but the important fact is that this is a drawing, you see? And this drawing is associated no more to one vector bundle to over one geometric object, but it is associated to some new invariant associated by Grothendieck to this geometric object. This is what I have written K, K of X, K of Y. And it is associated to a morphism, to a morphism from a geometric object X to another geometric object Y. So this means that Grothendieck had transformed the formula for one geometric object into a diagram associated to morphism from one object to another object. So what he did was really to make the Riemann-Rohr theorem categorical. And in the process of formulating and proving this incredibly more general theorem, Grothendieck introduced a new invariant of geometric objects, which by now has become a whole new part of mathematics. It is so-called K-theory. And I want to say a few words about that. So what he did is to associate to a geometric object X the full category of vector bundles on X, or the full category of so-called coherent linear sheaves on X. So these two categories are instances of so-called additive categories. And here, Grothendieck introduced an extremely simple definition. For any additive category with an induced notion of so-called short exact sequence, he was able to define a group, so the so-called Grothendieck group of this category. And here, in fact, on the page, I have written the definition. So I don't expect you to understand it, but I want to stress the fact that this definition is very simple. You can write it in a few lines. So you just consider the free abelian group generated by all objects of the category divided out by the relations associated to short exact sequences. And you see, this is very simple. And so this is a definition of just a few lines. So if I summarize, when you start with a geometric object X, you associate to this geometric object two categories, the categories vec X of vector bundles and the category mod X of linear coherent sheaves. Then there are the associated Grothendieck groups. And if your category, your geometric object X has no singularity, in fact, these two Grothendieck groups are proved to be isomorphic. And this is the category of X. On the other, you have to remark something. We already said that categories are too big. They are too general. They have too many objects. So you may have the feeling you cannot work with them. But here, what Grothendieck did is to start from a concrete geometric object X, to associate to it categories which are too big. This is true. These categories are too big. But then he defines invariants for these categories. And here, what he has shown is that this invariants, whose definition is derived from the categories he considered, this invariants, so the K group, K of X, are amenable to computation. And in fact, they have proved so interesting for mathematics that by now, these objects have become a whole part of mathematics. Then, I also want to mention the categorification of cohomology. So cohomology is the most important part of 20th century mathematics. It has helped to solve many, many problems in many parts of mathematics. So before the Grothendieck, cohomology was already defined for linear sheaves on topological spaces, and it was also defined for linear representations of groups. So what Grothendieck did is to study the categories of linear sheaves and the categories of linear representations of groups and to realize that they share some properties. So they are so-called abelian categories. And in the process, Grothendieck defines the notion of abelian category. And they verify a few extra properties, which are exactly what are needed to do cohomology. And so the consequence of this identification of the needed properties by Grothendieck was that after his paper, it was possible to develop cohomology in any abelian category verifying these properties, which was a huge generalization of what existed before. But then you may ask, is it possible to construct or how to construct abelian categories verifying these cohomology-friendly properties? More precisely, is it possible to imagine a construction process which generalizes at the same time the construction of linear sheaves from the construction of the category of linear sheaves from a topological space and the construction of the category of linear representations from a group, or more generally, a monoid? And here, Grothendieck proposed the following answer. He considered a category endowed with the topology. In fact, we have already considered that when talking about Grothendieck categorification of Galois theory, the notion of topology on a category. So then he considered a pair, which he called a site, and he showed that any time that we have a topology on a category, there is an associated category of linear sheaves. And this process generalizes both the definition of linear sheaves on a topological space and the definition of representations of a group or a monoid. And in fact, the categories of linear sheaves always verify the cohomology-friendly properties which are needed to do cohomology. And at that point, Grothendieck did another step, which he called a child-like or child-minded step. He just remarked, but why do we consider only linear sheaves? We could consider sheaves just of sets. It makes sense. And then he decided to consider the categories of sheaves of sets on an arbitrary site. And the categories defined in that way, he called toposes. So here I denote them in this way. The category C with a hat and with an index J, because it can be understood as some type of completion of the category C. In fact, category C has many completions. It has a completion for any choice of a topology of C. And if the topology is discrete, is trivial, what you get is just the category C hat of networks of C, which we have already talked about. Okay, so here it has also to be said that there is a double characterization of topologies, either a constructive definition through the sheaf process, but also an axiomatic characterization. It was proved by a Grothendieck student, Giro, that a topos is a category which verifies the same properties, which has just as good properties as the categories, as the category of sets. Okay, so I think I will try to go quicker. So another thing Grothendieck did is to categorify Poincaré duality. So Poincaré duality is most important general property of cohomology. So for Poincaré, it was a duality between cohomology spaces. And here, it has to be mentioned that Grothendieck did that categorical, in categorical terms. He understood Poincaré duality in categorical terms. I don't have the time to explain it, but it is really a miracle of mathematics. Here it is incredible that Grothendieck was able to imagine such a reformulation of Poincaré duality. So this is the so-called six operation functors. And in the process of proving that, he defined a new class of categories, which he called derived categories. So here in the, on the page, it appears at the bottom. So you see there were these new definitions. So here on the page, you can see this notation, F with an exclamation point either up or down, and this notation D of A. So these were new definitions by Grothendieck. And this new definition have made category theory, and especially sheaf theory, extremely powerful. So here I just want to let you dream on the drawings you see. So this is the cohomological translation of the geometric notion of smoothness, no singularity, and of compactness. And here it is another miracle of category theory that it is possible to translate these notions in categorical terms at the level of cohomology. So here you see these notions can be translated in the way I have drawn. The left diagram should imply a so-called commutative square on the right. So you see this is an implication between diagrams. And another miracle of this formulation is that the local property of smoothness and the global property of compactness are expressed almost exactly in the same way. For they are expressed by the same implication between diagrams. For compactness, F is fixed and G is arbitrary. For smoothness, G is fixed and F is arbitrary. So you just exchange the role of what is fixed and what is arbitrary. So then I have to mention also the categorification of homotopy theory. So here the most important names are Kahn, Daniel Coulet, and also Grothendieck himself. So this categorification has given birth to a new part of mathematics, which is called higher category theory, by now infinity category theory. And here I have to mention the most important name, Jacob Lurie. So this theory has become very important in mathematics. It is studied by many mathematicians, and not only mathematicians. It has become important even for some physicists. but I, we have to mention it was not done in a systematic way. So the development of higher category theory is really driven by applications. And it is really wonderful that something so abstract, because it is extremely abstract, in fact, is driven by applications. Okay, but I will not talk anymore about higher categories, which in fact is another subject. I want to come back to category theory. So here, I come back to toposes. So, and to what Grothendieck proved about toposes. So, I already mentioned that there is a topos, a category of sheaves of sets, associated to any category C endowed with a topology J. And then, a miracle of category theory is that it is possible to define, in purely categorical terms, the notion of subtoposes of a topos, or the notion of open or closed subtoposes, the notion of intersection or unions of a topos, the notion of point of a topos. So you see, all the words I am introducing here, all the words I am using here, are words borrowed from geometry. But it is possible to define this notion in purely categorical terms, so this means in purely combinatorial terms. And you do it in such a way, or Grothendieck did it in such a way, that the notion on the geometric or topological side and the notion of the categorical side coincide. So this means that, for instance, the points of a topological space correspond to the points of the associated topos of sheaves on this topological space. And the same goes for open subobjects, for closed subobjects, for intersections, for unions, they all correspond. But the advantage of that is that the notion of topos is much more general than the notion of topological space. So in this way, you can bring the vocabulary and the intuitions of geometry to a much more general setting than the setting of classical topology or geometry. So here you have, there is also a notion of morphism between toposes. And in fact, if your toposes are associated to topological spaces, a morphism on the topos side corresponds to a continuous map on the topological side. But here, we have to remember that the topos may be defined, is defined in general by a site. And here, it has to be mentioned that, in fact, any single topos can be defined by infinitely many different sites, which means couples consisting in a category endowed with a topology. Okay, so this means there is incredibly more flexibility in the notion of site than in the notion of topological space. I also have to mention that toposes are not only related to geometry, but also to logic. So here I have mentioned the names of the few people who have played a role in that respect, beginning with Grothendieck himself. So it all stems from the fact that a topos is just as good properties as the category of sets. So this means that it is possible to do mathematics in the context of a topos, of an arbitrary topos, exactly as we are used to do mathematics in the context of sets. So in particular, if you have any so-called first-order theory, for instance, an algebraic theory, the theory of groups, the theory of rings, the theory of vector spaces, and so on, then it is possible to consider models, which means realizations of this theory, not only in sets, but in an arbitrary topos. And so for any theory T, on any topos E, there is an associated category of realizations of this theory in the topos. And here comes a very important and wonderful theorem, which is the following fact. Start with such a first order theory. Then for any topos, you can consider the word, which is a category, in fact, of realization of this theory in that topos. And if we have a morphism from a topos to another topos, there is an associated functor in the reverse direction, transforming realizations of the theory T in the second topos into realization of the theory T in the first topos. And here, the most important theorem is that this functor is representable by a particular topos. So this means there is a particular topos ET such that for any topos E, the realization of the theory T in E corresponds to the morphism from E to ET. In particular, the set theoretic realization of T, for instance, the set theoretic groups, correspond to the category of points of the topos. For the theory of groups, there is an associated topos such that groups in the usual sense correspond to points of that geometric object, the classifying topos of the theory of groups. And here is a very important remark that for any topos, there are infinitely many theories which define the same topos. So here, this remark is extremely important. In some sense, it is some kind of duality between language and meaning. What can also say a duality between freedom and truth. The topos incarnate truth, but there is freedom. And the freedom is in the way to speak about truth. There are infinitely many languages which allow to talk about the same truth. Okay, so here I want to mention the development of category theory, which was invented and developed by Olivia Caramello in the last, so she began in 2008, 12 years ago, during her PhD work. And Olivia Caramello is one of the Gelfand chair holders at IHES presently. So her idea is the following. Her idea is to take advantage of the fact that any topos can be associated to many different theories or to many different sites. So here I have written these possible equivalences between toposes defined in different ways. And then our idea is to consider invariance of toposes, which means properties or constructions associated to toposes and stable under equivalence, and to express them in terms of the defining sites of theories. And in this way, you can get correspondences between sites or between theories or between a site and a theory which are completely different. And in this way, you get correspondences which are most of the time completely unexpected. So this, I think, is very important because it opens the possibility to develop a general mathematical theory of relations between the contents of different theories. So in other words, it is a possibility to develop a mathematical theory of translations. And it is extremely important because in mathematics, most of the time, the result, the formula, for instance, is a relation, an equivalence, between two ways of computing, for instance, or between two theories. An equation is an equality between two things defined in two different ways, which means these are the result of applying two theories. So this means that mathematics consists in building relations between different theories. And here you have the possibility to study this thing in a mathematical way. You see, the duality of sides and theories on the one hand and opposites on the other hand opens the possibility to develop a mathematical theory of relations between the content of theories. Okay, so Caramello has applied that to many different contexts, and I want to mention the application she had made to Galois' theory. Because by this very simple idea, she was able to generalize, and for me it was really a surprise, I didn't expect that at all, she was able to generalize the Galois formalism of Grothendieck. So let's recall that Grothendieck had characterized the categories which are equivalent to categories of actions of a group. And so the simple idea of Caramello is to characterize the sites, which means the category endowed with a topology, such that the associated topos is equivalent to the category of actions of a group. And this is much more general than the previous result. And then, when you do that, you realize that the only possible topology on the category is the so-called atomic topology, you can describe it. And so this is a property of the category itself. And you can explicitly write what are the needed properties for a category endowed with the atomic topology to be Galois in this sense. And here you discover, or Olivia Caramello has discovered, that in fact, in mathematical practice, there are incredibly many categories which verify these properties. She has also discovered that, in fact, through this formalism, there is a possibility to unify Galois theory and an important part of so-called model theory in logic, which is the so-called Frise construction or theorem. So this means this is yet another unification. You remember Grothendieck had unified Galois theory and Poincaré theory of fundamental group. And here there is yet another unification with the so-called Frise construction in model theory, in particular with the notion of homogeneous model, which is important in some parts of mathematics. And this also is completely new, and it is just an easy consequence of the basic idea of bridge, of topos theoretic bridges. So, by now, of course, I want to mention the relationship we built with Huawei. So, in fact, I first heard about Huawei by Jean-Pierre Bourguignon, the former director of IHS. But my first meeting with people from Huawei was just 3 years ago, in July 2017. I was invited to give a talk in a conference on the Math Vision Forum organized by Huawei in Luberon, south of France. And it was my first contact with these people, Benjamin Coulomer, Merwan Deba, Jean-Claude Belfior. And in fact, I didn't imagine that I could talk about something which could be interesting for them. So this means that first I refused, and then they insisted, and I refused again, but they insisted again. And in the end, I say, okay, I come. And I gave a talk about topozis, because I had been convinced by Caramello that topozis were extremely important, were some of the most important objects in mathematics, exactly as Grothendieck had said repeatedly. But I didn't think that my talk would have consequences. So I gave a very informal and relaxed talk, and I also had informal conversation with the people there, so it was very nice. And it was especially nice because I thought that nothing was at stake. Once again, I couldn't imagine that this very abstract stuff I was talking about could be really interesting for these people working for an industrial company. But in fact, I was completely wrong. In fact, I discovered, and later Caramello also discovered, that these people from Huawei especially Jean-Claude Belfiore, Merwan, Benjamin Coulomer, and others we met, were really interested about what we could say about toposes and categories. We were listened to. And so the consequence of that, of course, for us, was first the support for a topos program at IHS, and also the support from Huawei for a PhD program, for the PhD program of Olivia Caramello in Italy. Certainly, it also played a role for IHS. So the support from Huawei to IHS was already very important, but it became even more important. And here, Huawei people know what was the role of this meeting in that respect. The most striking, another really incredible for me consequence is the fact that this talk, this informal talk I gave, also had consequences for some mathematicians working for Huawei. So they became really interested into toposes, into categories. Some Huawei mathematicians attended summer school about toposes. Caramello, Alan Cohn, and myself organized in Como 2 years ago. And Jean-Claude Belfiore began to work on toposes and related subjects, as I will immediately mention, so stacks, quantum derivatives, together with Daniel Benkin. So Daniel Benkin is, of course, an academic mathematician who had just officially retired from university, and he was recruited by Huawei as a consultant. And in fact, I will immediately say, he has done wonderful, already done wonderful work with Jean-Claude Belfiore related to categories and toposes. And in fact, Daniel Belkin had become interested in toposes before, independently from Caramello, from myself, from Alan Cohn, and from all these people. But probably there was a contact between Huawei and Daniel Belkin because of the new interest of Huawei for toposes. So anyway, I suppose that. But anyway, Belkin began to work with Jean-Claude Belfiore in particular. And this work for me began to become concrete in a workshop, deep dive in topos theory, which was organized at the Huawei Math Center in Paris last January. And so their well talk was several people, so by Caramello, by myself, by Daniel Belkin, by Jean-Claude Belfiore, also by Juan Pablo Vigno. And in fact, I already was very impressed by how fast these people on the Huawei side had gone. In fact, even today, I am very, very surprised and very impressed. And I really find it wonderful. And in fact, Jean-Claude Belfiore and Daniel Belkin recently sent to me some preprints they have written. So they are still drafts, but the drafts are already quite consistent. And so the name of the title of the first draft is Topos and Stacks of Deep Neural Networks. Deep Neural Networks is the basic architecture for artificial intelligence. And here you see topos and stack. And stack is another notion invented by Grothendieck under the French name champ. And it is closely related to topos, with immediately said. And here I have just listed from the introduction of the paper, the content of the paper. And this paper is interesting, I guess, for deep neural network, but it is also very interesting on the mathematical side. And you see all these notions, sites, toposes, stacks, fiber categories over a site, the relationship with logic, the relationship with semantic, which I already talked about, the true category of stacks. So here you see the model, the Kuhlen theory of models. You see homology and homotopy invariants, which here are really invariants of toposes. So all of these appear in the paper. In this preprint, and this is for concrete application to artificial intelligence. So this is extremely impressive for me. The paper is very nice to read. It is a pleasure for a pure mathematician, but I also understand that it is important for imputation. And in fact, Jean-Claude Belfior recently wrote to me that they already have very interesting experimental results. I only quote what he told me, with some unexpected logical behavior. Okay, and by now, almost last thing I want to mention is that, in fact, Caramello herself, completely independently from this Huawei people and from Daniel Belka, is working in particular on general questions which are very close to what Benka, Belfior and others also work. So for Benka and Belfior, this is because of the interest for deep neural networks. And for Caramello, it is for general interest of the development of theory of category. So for Caramello, it is a theme of relative toposes. So the study of a morphism from a topos to another topos. You see, not to consider only one topos, but the structure consisting of a topos over a base topos. And in fact, so on the IHS website, you can find an IHS preprint of 170 pages on the general study of morphism and of toposes, characterization in terms of size. And, there is also a secret paper of Olivia, which I hope will soon become public, about the full expression of morphism of toposes in terms of defining sites. And there is presently the development of Caramello together with a PhD student, Ricardo Zanfa, of the general study of relative toposes, both with the language of geometry, which is largely the language of stacks, you see, exactly as in the Belfior-Benkin paper, and also the study of this situation from the point of view of logic. And here, this is very interesting because when you study that, you see higher order logic coming in. You see logic of second order. And you can imagine that if you want to get logic of order n, you have to consider not two toposes, but a chain of n toposes related by morphism. So this is presently a work in progress by Caramello and her student Ricardo Zanfa. And I think this is really very, very important. So I want to conclude with some lessons for the development of mathematics. So the first lesson for me, first, is that applied mathematicians or pure mathematicians who care about applications may be very open-minded and have very good judgment. So this, I really learned a lesson from them. It is a pleasure for me to talk with them. I am very impressed by also the speed. You see, for instance, Grothendieck complained in the 80s that the mathematical academic community was not taking seriously enough the notion of topos he had introduced. But here, you see, I talked informally to people from Huawei about topos just 3 years ago. And 3 years after that, they are already not only working on toposes, but working on it in a really interesting way, both for applications and for theoretical mathematics. So this means that here there is a lesson for the academic world of pure mathematics. We really have to learn something. Here there is also the lesson that I want to say that when Grothendieck insists that something is important, it is a good idea to take him seriously. And you see, this is true for the subject of toposes, and it is also true for the subject of derivators, which was a notion invented and developed by Grothendieck completely alone in the 80s. And this notion was not considered by the academic community, or almost not considered, but by now it is used by Daniel Benka and Jean-Claude Belfiore on their work on deep neural networks. So for me, it is very striking for me that this notion, which Grothendieck introduced, and he wrote, I think, hundreds and hundreds of pages on the subject, this notion is by now studied seriously by people interested in applications. Here, I want to make a suggestion, which would be, so maybe a suggestion for Huawei, we would be to create a new institute devoted to topologies and related subjects and to applications, for instance, the subject of derivatives also. I really think that topologies is a huge subject, and it deserves to be developed in a systematic way with important means. This is very important for pure mathematics, and then we can see that it also can have applications. And the last thing I want to say is a praise of IHES as an independent institute. So this is something I experience by talking with mathematicians. So IHES professors, so for instance, Kahn, Gromov, Koncevich, these people are able to think and evaluate for themselves. They can have personal opinions. Whereas a problem of the mathematical communities, of the academic world, is that too often it is submitted to group thinking. You try to talk to somebody, but you realize that somebody is not ready, he doesn't want to formulate or to conceive a personal opinion. He's just waiting for the opinion of other people, for the opinion of the group. But IHES is a small institute and it is independent. It has professors who are strong personalities and they are able to make personal judgment. And I think this is also very important for mathematics. So thank you very much for your attention.